Nudged presents The Royal Bake Off by Clementine Beauvais, narrated by Melody Grove. The story so far. Britland Blather. Prince Pepino found after 3 days of Francian wanderings. The heir to the throne of Britland, Prince Pepino, has been found again after disappearing for 3 days. "We bumped into Pepino at the wedding of Princess Violette of Francia," said Queen Sheila. "He'd been to Paris with his friends without telling us, the cheeky little monkey." The prince and his two friends, Holly and Anna Burnbright, reportedly worked in Paris for Francian royal wedding organiser Mademoiselle Malipons. It's been a busy week for the three children, who last Monday repelled the invasion of Britland by King Alas Poor Yorick of Daneland. The royal family of Britland was attending the wedding of Violette of Francia to King Dentu of Romani, although the Francian princess changed her mind at the last minute and married a non-royal she was actually in love with. "Young princesses these days," sighed Queen Sheila. "They think they need to be in love to get married, when in fact it's all a matter of how well your future spouse plays table football." It is believed that the three children are trying to earn money to go on the holy moly holiday advertised in all the Britland newspapers. Anna Burnbright stated, "We're looking for another summer job, since we didn't get paid for that one." Let's hope for the sake of those greedy young girls that the next job pays a little more than that. Chapter 1. There is nothing quite so bothersome as badly combed seaweed, especially when it's growing on a pile of rocks on the beach outside the windows of your royal palace. Thus, Queen Sheila and King Steve of Britland, one sunny summer morning after returning from Francia, asked Prince Pepino and Holly and Anna Burnbright to work as rock hairdressers for the day.
"Just make them look pretty," said Queen Sheila. "We'll reward you, of course. You'll each get a new island named after you."
"Can we have real money instead?" asked Anna.
"What a disgusting request," King Steve exclaimed. "What do you need money for?"
"A holiday we saw advertised in the newspaper," said Anna. They had explained this to the King and Queen many times, but they kept forgetting. That holiday was called the Holy Moly Holiday, and it sounded like the absolute best experience of a lifetime. It was also very expensive.
"Holy Moly Holiday. This summer, treat yourself to the intergalactic holiday of a lifetime, not for the faint-hearted or the unadventurous."
Day 1. Scuba dive in the molten lava of the Eyjafjallajökull volcano of Islandia. Day 2. Learn to play polo on baby elephant back in the savannas of Africa. Day 3. Build a faster-than-light spaceship in Americanada. Day 4. Fly the faster-than-light spaceship to Mars and have Martian cocktails at a local bar. Day 5. Back to Earth. Have a rest and celebrate the end of your holy moly holiday in your 10-star hotel with taps of hot chocolate, lemonade and chicken soup, unlimited, marshmallow pillows, unlimited, jacuzzi in every room, the size of an Olympic swimming pool, TV with 3 million channels, none of them boring, and much more, including a big, secret surprise gift.
"Why can't you ask your parents for money?" asked King Steve.
"We only have our mum, and she's poor," said Holly. "Their dad had disappeared years ago in the beak of a pelican. That sort of thing is unlucky, but happens rarely enough that one shouldn't worry too much about it in everyday life. She's a writer of ABC books, and there isn't much she can do to get paid more. A is always worth £1, and B another pound, and she's never allowed to add more letters to the alphabet."
"We will pay you £1 per rock,"
said King Steve. And I will pass a new law adding 2 letters to the alphabet. Or even 3.
It might be complicated, said Queen Sheila. But all right, dear, if you wish.
Prince Pepino, Holly and Anna started their job immediately, armed with a new rock hairdressing kit. Accessories, hairnet, comb, clips, scissors, earrings, mirror. They soon realised that the job wasn't going to be easy. The brown seaweed was too rubbery to be plaited, and the green seaweed was full of sand mite.
"That's the 10th crab that refuses to be clipped at the end of a braid," Anna cursed.
"And I'm having trouble with those anemones," Holly complained. "They keep squirting seawater on me when I try to cut that rock's fringe."
"You're just not very talented," said Prince Pepino. "My rocks are already much prettier."
Anna threw away the crab, which stuck its tongue out at her.
"I feel," she said, "like my life is spent working, 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 with no deeper meaning at all."
"I know," said Pepino sadly. "It happens to me when I've been learning times tables for 3 minutes. I just want to scream."
Ah!
The 3 children looked up at the palace. That high-pitched scream could only have come from 1 mustachioed mouth, King Steve's.
"What's wrong, Dad?"
Pepino shouted up. "Did you step on one of the Bertie's pet centipedes again?" The king appeared at the window, looking as pale as a frog's belly.
"I've just had my brother on the phone," he said.
"Poor Daddy," whispered Pepino. "Let's go back to the palace. He'll need to be fed marshmallows through a tube." King Steve was lying on his bed eating flapjacks, cookies, peanut butter cups and, of course, marshmallows. The Queen was fanning him with a cloud of candy floss, which King Steve stuffed in his mouth as the children walked in.
"My darling," said the Queen, "what can Sam possibly have said to make you so distressed?"
"Uncle Sam," Pepino explained quietly to Holly and Anna, "is the Emperor of Americanada. He married the Empress, but she's always abroad with her army, so he basically rules the country on his own. The biggest, richest country in the world. It makes Dad a little bit jealous."
"Jealous?" sniffled King Steve, blowing his nose in the royal bedcovers. "I'm not jealous of my brother. I don't care that he's richer than me, and more handsome and successful. I don't even care that he's decided to start baking."
"Baking?" the Queen exclaimed. "Oh, Stevie, darling, don't tell me—"
"That's right. The only thing I do well. He had to try it too. And of course he does it seriously now. He's taking classes. He's already won competitions in Americanada."
Queen Sheila tut-tutted. The king, having run out of bed covers, attempted to blow his nose into the fur of one of their Angora kittens. The kitten bit his chin.
"And of course," said King Steve, "it's not enough for Sam. He must show me that he's the best at it. He's organising a royal bake-off, and he wants me to be a contestant."
"Oh, you'll win easily, Daddy," said Pepino. "You're the best ever cake maker. Remember when you won the Southeast Britland crabapple crumble competition? Look, the picture's still on the wall."
Best crabapple crumble, King Steve of Britland.
"Crabapple crumbles,"
King Steve snorted.
"Look at the picture Sam sent me on the Vizio phone. He's just finished making a life-sized nougat and praline skyscraper. 100 floors, with energy drink-powered lifts. Of course his people adore him."
"Your people adore you too," said Queen Sheila. "The newspapers keep saying how much of a laugh you are."
"That's because they love at me," moaned King Steve. You think I didn't read today's news story mocking me because I still can't count to 10? I've read it 1, 2, 3, 8, 4, 5, 9, 6, 8, 10 times. I've had enough. I will take up his challenge. I will take part in the Royal Bake Off.
Oh, Steve, we're all so proud of you, the Queen stammered, a bit tearful.
I need to find some assistance, said the King. Sam mentioned that each contestant could bring up to 3 kitchen helpers, who would be paid £500 each. The only condition is that they should have no baking experience whatsoever. Where could I find people like that?
Ahem, coughed Anna. Ahem, ahem, ahem. Ahem, coughed Holly. Ahem.
After 10 or so minutes of coughing, the Queen, King and Prince understood what they were alluding to, and King Steve phoned his brother to roar,
I'm coming, Sam, and with the 3 most unqualified assistants in the world.
Chapter 2. The next day, Holly and Anna arrived at the Royal Palace Airport early with tidy little suitcases. Prince Pepino and King Steve's suitcases were a bit less tidy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.